Hey, let's open our Bibles up to the book of Jeremiah and chapter 29. And we're going to go to verse 11. And maybe somebody could find it in the King James. Somebody else might find the literal version. Someone else might find the Young's version. And then somebody might have the modern King James version. Because we're going to read all four different versions. How about that? Because this is one of our favorite verses.
Yeah, it's great.
So who wants to have a go at the King James version?
I will. Okay. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an unexpected end.
An expected end.
Expected end.
You have me worried. Hey, who has the literal version?
For I know the purposes which I'm planning for you, says Jehovah, purposes of peace and not for evil, to give you posterity and a hope.
Amen. Who's got the modern King James? The MKJV. And while somebody's looking for that, somebody else might have the Young's version. Who's got the Young's version? And I really love this version. I really do, especially the beginning of it.
For I have known the thought that I am thinking towards
you. Now, hey, let's just stop there for a moment. For I have known.
Yeah.
Don't you like that?
Mm.
If we'll get in step with God, the way is already prepared.
No.
Amen. Amen. No. God's not surprised.
Mm-hmm.
He has a good way for us.
That's why I probably said it's an unexpected end.
For I have known the thoughts that I'm thinking towards you. Mm. Yeah, somebody can carry on that. Carry on.
An affirmation of Jehovah, the thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you posterity and hope.
Amen. And somebody else has got the modern King James by now?
I can't find the modern King James. Are you talking about New King James or is it literally called modern?
It's called MKJV.
I mean, I like the sound of it.
Yeah, it's the same writer as the literal, Green.
No, I can't find it. Sorry, I've even Googled.
I'll read it for you.
It must be the Muslim one.
This is the one I like. That's why I like it. For I know the purposes which I am purposing for you, says Jehovah, purposes of peace and not evil, to give you a future and a hope. Now, the reason that I just felt my heart lean to this verse this week is because we mentioned it last week at Somerset.
Mm-hmm.
And we mentioned it, but I don't think we went to it and actually read from the Bible concerning it. But it really struck with me.
Yeah.
So mm-hmm. This week I just wanted to look at it and maybe glean something from it that would be very helpful as concerning the message going forward for this year. All right? So one of the first things that I noticed was this. For I know the thoughts. I love that. Not one thought, not one purpose for me, but God has many thoughts. And if you like, many purposes for me. Amen? And I thought that was an interesting thing. And we'll discuss that as we kind of go along. Now, when these thoughts and purposes are combined and put into action, this will give me an expected or a sure outcome. Amen. A future and a hope. Amen. The King James says, as we read, an expected end. Now, if we go to the Hebrew, that word expected is the word tikvah. And it literally means cord. Now, what's so important about the Hebrew language? Why is that such a great help to us? Well, two things. See, it's a bit different to the Greek. Two things. It gives us the meaning of the Hebrew word, but it also gives us the character of the Hebrew word. And that's important. Amen. Yep. Because when we think of a chord, what does that remind us of? What's the picture you get?
Like a song, something harmonized together?
Well, it's not quite that kind. Keys. All right. It's actually a string or a rope.
Oh, yeah.
A chord is a string or a rope. All right. And what's significant about a rope is that it has a beginning and it has an end. And in between, see, it's not like a stick of timber. In between, it can go kind of anywhere, can't it? It can go in all directions. It can have all different shapes, all right? But what is fixed about a cord or a rope, it has a fixed beginning and it has a fixed end, amen? Now, we could say that the cord represents life, all right? Physically speaking, a journey begins at conception. And, of course, where does it end? It ends at death, doesn't it? Amen. And, of course, we know that this death, even physical death, is a serious matter. Amen. Mm-hmm. Because the journey that we live determines the place of our eternity. Amen. So considering this, how I live, how you live, which we could call the journey, is a serious matter.
Amen.
Is it not? You should not take life and living lightly.
Amen.
Because it's going to determine the rest of your existence. Mm-hmm. Amen. Now, when we think physically, we have no control over the ends of the cord. Physically, we have no control over our physical birth, when we are born, where we are born, and who our parents are. Amen. And of course, we have no control over our death. True. But we do control one thing.
The headline, we're getting the graphic ready, Nigel, but your headline, Royal Security Warning, Harry has made Invictus Games a target.
Who's that coming from? Anyway, I was worried myself. Thought,
yeah.
That was my brain is talking. But see, what we do control is between the ends of the cord, don't we? We do control that. Definitely. We control the journey. Let's call it the journey.
Yep.
We control the journey by the choices we make. Mm-hmm. Amen? Sadly, and we know this, many allow the flesh to control their life.
Mm-hmm.
And therefore, according to Romans chapter 8, if you live after the flesh, your expected end is what?
Death.
An eternity without God, is it not?
Separation.
Amen. Again, let me reiterate, you only control the journey by the choices you make, which for most are controlled by the flesh. You know, the physical, the earthy, the bias is toward the flesh. Amen? So even an unsaved person must consider Galatians 6 and verse 7 and 8. It's a universal law. It cannot be broken. Amen? It says, be not be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. For he that soweth to the flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption, but he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap everlasting life. Now, for clarity, if you sow nothing, what do you get? If you sow nothing, think in a practical sense. If you sow nothing, what do you get?
Nothing.
Weeds.
Weeds. Amen. Ah. Who said that? Weeds.
Angie.
Amen. So, hey, it does not matter how much Roundup you put on a piece of dirt, everything looks dead, but come back a few weeks later, and what will you see?
Weeds.
Weeds. And what does that tell you?
She can't kill them.
That tells you you better sow something.
Yeah.
Because if you don't sow anything, the earth, in type the world, will sow something in your life.
Yes.
Which you may not like. Amen? So the advice is this. If you are not going to serve God, at least sow something. Amen? Now, we've read this in the Bible a few times from Jeremiah 10 and verse 23. Because our focus is not on the worldlings and the unsaved people. The focus is on us who are born again. Now, it says this in Jeremiah 10 and verse 23. Lord, I know the way of man is not in himself. It is not in a man that walketh to direct his steps. Now, of course, the context here is what? The context here, of course, is walking the path of God and righteousness. Because man certainly can walk his own path. And many do it each and every day. But of course, the result of that is darkness, is it not? More and more away from God. So the context here is walking the path of God and righteousness. Amen? Therefore, we can thank God that God has a plan and a purpose for us within his plans, plural, and purposes. Because God has more than one plan. God has more than one purpose. Amen? God didn't create one man and then make clones. Amen? So, first of all, of course, what was God's plan in his plans? And that was to give us, to give mankind the opportunity of a new, or what we call a different birth.
Yeah.
Amen? Now, this birth is one you control. You control the beginning. Amen? You choose whether you want to enjoy this born-again experience or not.
Amen.
Remember, physical birth, you got no choice. Amen. You can't say, oh, I don't like this country. I wish I was born somewhere else. You can wish and wish and wish until the cows come home. Amen. You can say, oh, I wish I didn't have these parents. Or you can wish and wish and wish until the cows come home. Amen. You just got to work with the cards you have been dealt physically. Make the best of it, in other words. But when God makes the way for this new birth, you control the beginning, you control the journey, and you control the end. Amen? Now, we go back to Jeremiah 29 and verse 11 and the expression expected end. Now, other versions say a future and a hope. A posterity and a hope. And of course, they're all pointing to the end of the cord. Amen? The end. And of course, that word tikvah. Now, that word tikvah, that Hebrew word, which gives us meaning and character, also, if you look in your Strong's, means that which you long for. And that's important, that which you long for. Amen? Mm-hmm. Clearly then, the journey will be set by what you long for. Amen? You see, think about goals. Goals, a goal is but a vain imagination until you take steps to achieve it. Yeah, especially you think of this time of year, and a week or so back, many, many people would have set all these different goals for 2023. But for most of them, it will just be a vain imagination because they won't put legs to what their goal is to achieve it. Amen? Now, when we think of the journey, the between the beginning and the end, the journey has many twists and turns. If you look at your own life, even after having been born again, your life was not, your born again experience was not just a straight line, was it not? Was not like a stick of timber.
No.
There have been many twists and turns. But your ability to navigate this journey is governed by the end game, what you long for.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. What you long for. Amen. Therefore, before you go another day, this is what you must decide. You must look toward the end of your life and then what you long for. You see, worldly people long for earthy things. They crave for that. But what do you long for? What do you crave for? Amen? You see, once you settle that, if your end goal is heaven after death, then from today you must live in the presence of God.
Amen.
Your journey must be in the presence of God. Why do I say that? Well, because we go back to Jeremiah 10 and 23. I know the way of man is not in himself. It is not in man that walketh to direct his own steps. Remember, the steps are the journey.
Yeah.
Amen. The steps will guide and lead you to the end, what you long for. Amen. But you are not capable, I am not capable of making the right steps myself. Only God can direct my steps. Amen? If we go to Psalm 37 and verse 5, your journey must be in the presence of God. What does that mean? Jeremiah 10 and 23. Well, I can't plot my own journey. Then Psalm 37, verse 5 says what? Who's got Psalm 37, verse 5? Come on, we've got to get busy.
Commit thy way unto the Lord, trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass.
Amen. Now notice it says way, not ways.
Yes.
Why is that?
Jesus says, I am the way, the truth.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, but I don't think this is quite, this is not the mate of that verse.
No, but you have to be
right. What this is telling us is this: the journey is one step, one purpose, one thought at a time.
Mm-hmm.
In spite of what the world might tell you, you cannot multitask.
Mm-hmm.
You can only do one thing at a time in the moment. True or not?
True.
Commit thy way unto the Lord, trust in him, and he shall bring it, notice, singular, it, to pass. Amen. Now, some, of course, read Psalm 37 and verse 5 and go along this way, all right? Just tell God what you're going to do, your plans, and he'll take care of it. And that is not what it says. Amen? Of course, many believers don't necessarily, all right, say what I've just said, just tell God what you're going to do and just go ahead and do whatever you want to do. But many believers in spirit do it just like that. They just run their life their own way. Amen? And of course, the excuse that many use, and maybe you do, maybe I do, that the practicalities of life, family, job, income, entertainment, whatever, that they can take care of them things or take them into their own hands. I can take care of that. And that is a grave mistake. It's the wrong decision. Because we can't do anything unless God does it and leads us himself. Amen? If we decide that we are going to decide what we are going to do with our family, with our job, with our income, and so forth, it will lead to the wrong end. Why do I say that? Well, how many of us have taken things in our own hands? Not once, but twice or many times. How many times must we repeat our own failures? How many times must we go around the mountain before the penny drops, where we start saying, stop, God, what is your plan? What do you say? Amen. What is your choice? What is your decision in this matter? Amen. What does that take? It takes prayer, sometimes fasting, and most definitely study. Amen. Study. For instance, we'll just do a couple examples, all right? Now, God says concerning husbands and wives, in the book of Proverbs 18 and verse 22, whoso findeth a wife findeth a good thing and obtaineth favor of the Lord. Now, of course, you can just run with that verse and just make your own decisions. Because if you find a wife, find a husband, that's a good thing. But I tell you what, I think that 70 or 80%, even in Australia, will tell you that the wife or husband they found was the wrong thing. I mean, because that's kind of the failure rate of relationships in Australia. Amen. So obviously it does not mean whoever or whatever you find, amen, but rather you have to study. If you're in the husband or wife looking for one, all right, as a believer, you need to study, all right, because, amen, our choices are not based on our choice, but God's choice in accordance with what Paul taught in 1 Corinthians chapter 7. You've got to study. So you find the right one. You see, we are not ruled by lust in the flesh. But sometimes what looks good on the outside and not so good on the inside, amen?
Amen.
But our choices must be based on that person's love and devotion to God. True?
Mm-hmm.
Now, we might be thinking, that's fair enough. Now, surely I must control my family. I must control my income. I must control my business. I must control my living. And, of course, the answer is yes, if you want to continue to fail. But see, because God tells us in Matthew chapter 6 and verse 33, we're talking about the journey, brothers and sisters.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you can't figure the journey unless God lights the way of your journey.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to get to the expected end. Because if you don't follow what God says, you'll end up at the wrong end. See, Matthew 6 and 33 says, seek ye first the kingdom of God, not second, not third, and his righteousness. And then all these things shall be added unto you. Read Matthew chapter 6, all the practicalities of life, of physical living. Mm-hmm. Amen? Now, of course, let me stress, his righteousness means what? The right way. Mm-hmm. If you want to get to the end of the string, amen, you got to go the right way. Amen. For us, the right way is what? In the moment, step by step. How do we do that? In the presence of God. Amen. Now, of course, the right way is not always a scripture you can find in the Bible. Amen? Because if you're not careful, people who just live their lives by, books, those scripture keys or whatever, all right, how can that end up? One can end up just following a formula. Amen? And we can all follow a formula outside the presence of God. And also remember that one size does not fit all. Amen? But take courage to serve God and to follow God is going to give you a great outcome. David testified, I've been young and now old, yet I've not seen the righteous. Remember, who are the righteous? The ones walking moment by moment in the right way, in the presence of God. Amen? I've not seen the righteous forsaken. How can we be forsaken? Think about it. Mm-hmm. If you're in step with God.
Mm-hmm.
Nor his seed begging for bread. Amen. And that in itself, you can just think about that and meditate upon that.
Hmm.
Amen. Now, some may be saying, yeah, Brother Gilbert, I need. Yes, we all need. Amen. But God says this through Paul in Philippians 4:19. But my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. maybe we would halve our needs if we simply followed this rule and sought God. Because when he supplies the need, it will satisfy. And then we have John's words in 3 John 2. Beloved, I wish above all things that you may prosper and be in health. But hey, the key, even as your soul prospers, amen. You see, a full and satisfying and successful journey is only realized by following the plans and purposes of God. Amen. One purpose, one thought, one plan at a time, moment by moment. Amen. In Jeremiah 29:11, for I know the thoughts, the purposes that I think toward you, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace, not evil, to give you an expected end. Now, my question is this. Why do you think many believers tend to make their own choices in the practicalities of life? Why do we not do what God says? I think there are two reasons, maybe three. One, heaven is not the longing of their soul. And you might think about that one for a moment. But Paul testified of this in Philippians chapter 1, verses 23 and 24. Somebody might want to read that for us. Because if your longing is not heaven, then your longing is for something else. You will live and make decisions based on your longing. He's got Philippians 1, verses 23 and 24, and I'll stop you some way through it.
For I am in a strait betwixt two, having a desire to depart.
Right, having a desire, that word desire, a longing for us, that is a longing, a desire to depart, longing to the end of the journey. Amen? Isn't that what he's saying?
Yes.
Okay, keep going.
And to be with Christ, which is far better.
Amen. So that is the end of the cord.
Yeah.
That's what he is longing for. That is his desire. That is his goal. What's he say then?
Nevertheless, to abide in the flesh is more needful for you.
Amen. Why was that? Because his journey is not complete. What's he saying? I must follow the plan of God. True? But see there, his longing, I mean, what he's aiming for at the end of the cord, the rope, is heaven. Amen? But he's also aware that between the beginning and the end, there is a journey that he must traverse, and that journey is not one of his own, but one set by God. Amen? You see, when the longing for the end of a cord is lost in the clouds and call it the smoke of this world, what tends to happen to believers? And when you're caught in the fog of this world, what do you tend to do?
Can't see correctly.
Amen. You tend to slow your walk in Christ, don't you? Many stagnate. Amen. They are the same in maturity as they were a year ago, 2 years ago, 3 years ago, a week ago. Amen. They become idle. Amen. They no longer do the works of the kingdom, but the works of their own. Amen. You see, they meander, yeah, like a river, all right, in and out of Christ, needing to be continually pumped up. Mm-hmm. Don't they? Mm-hmm. Especially think of our American brothers and sisters. They continually need revival meetings. They continually need camp meetings. Why? So they stay in. Mm-hmm. They didn't have those things. What would happen to them? God knows. Amen. I got a question for you. There is a pot of gold, a good treasure, and it's about 100 meters down the road. You can see it. It's glistening in the sun. What do you do? Let's say the love of your life has just come back from a long journey, and he or she is 100 meters down the road. What would you do? Would you walk the other way?
No, we'd run fast for him.
Would you just regularly and casually stroll towards he or her or the pot of gold?
Yeah, you don't want to seem too eager.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, you'd risk somebody else taking the pot of gold.
Treat him mean,
right?
Keep him keen. Yep.
Yeah. You see, most of us would do what Sister Eileen says. They would run as fast as they could. Would they not? Isn't that what they'd do? Amen. There's a pot of gold.
Yeah, and hope the other one runs as fast as they did. Yep.
What are you going to do? You're just going to just casually wander? You're going to run like crazy.
Yeah, and I hope they run too.
Amen. Run as fast as you can. Amen. Now, the reasons for one and two, right, which I just mentioned, all right? Amen. What was the first one? Was heaven is not the longing of the soul. The second was, the reason was, you know, one gets caught up in the affairs of this world. All right. What's the problem? How can I sum that up? Well, I can sum that up in Proverbs 29 and verse 18. Somebody got that for us? Proverbs 29, verse 18.
Where there is no vision, the people perish, but he that keepeth the law, happy is he.
Right. Now notice again, it doesn't say visions. It says vision.
The vision, yeah.
All right. Where there is not the vision, where there is no vision. Mm. Now, what's important about the Hebrew? It gives meaning and
character.
All right. Now, that Greek word for vision is the word shazon, which means sight, revelation, dream. But it comes from another Hebrew word, shazar. I love that. Shazon, shazar. And this, all right, now get the character, all right? The character, it means to behold, to look upon with pleasure. What does that remind you of? Does that not remind you of the end of the cord, tigfah, what you are longing for? Amen. Amen? You see, think about it. Only a fool would set a goal that he or she takes no pleasure in. True. I mean, it would just be, you can rest assured if you do that, your goal will fail and not be realized. There must be pleasure in the goal. There must be pleasure in the end. There must be pleasure at the end of the cord. Why? Why is that so important? Because along the way, the journey, there may be some unpleasantness, sacrifice, discipline, disappointments.
Yeah. Amen.
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 It is only the pleasure, that which you are longing for, gets you through the potholes.
Amen.
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 See, it is the achievement of the goal, obtaining the prize, that makes it all worthwhile. Makes all the sacrifices worth it. Makes all the discipline worth it. Makes all the rejections worth it. Amen. Makes all the disappointments worth it.
Mm-hmm.
All the headwinds worth it. The achievement, the end goal. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. So now you see the end of the cord. You behold the prize. You see the value of the prize. For you, it is the love and longing of your heart. What should you do? Paul gives us the answer. 1 Corinthians 9, verse 24. Down to verse 27. Who's got that for us?
Corinthians
9, verse 24. Begins with, know you not.
Know you not that they which run in a race run.
You stop there. We want some emphasis now. Know you not they which run. Not walk, not neander, not, you know, sit around. They that run in a race. Keep going now.
But one receives the prize.
So what should you do? Run! Run! Run that you may obtain. Don't hang around. Don't go slow, because you will miss. Run. Verse 25.
And every man that strives for the mastery is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we an incorruptible.
Amen. So what does Paul say? I therefore so run. Amen. He's not walking, you know, a slow walk in the park. He knows what he wants.
Amen.
And he's making haste to get it. I run. Okay.
Not as uncertainly, so fight I, not as one that beats the air, but I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest that by any means, when I have preached to others, I myself should be a castaway.
Amen. So don't be idle. Don't stagnate. Don't get sidetracked. Amen. Don't let the noise of this world distract you. But what? Run toward the prize.
Yeah.
I mean, this journey is not a walk, it's a running journey. Amen. Run toward the prize. And of course, what is the prize? That which you long for. How do we run? Philippians 2 and verse 16. How do we run? not everybody at once.
Holding forth the word of life, that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have not run in vain, neither leave the table in vain.
Amen. Holding forth, making God and his purposes the rule of my life.
Amen.
That I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have not run in vain. You see, there may be obstacles, there may be potholes, hindrances on the way, but God will navigate for us. Look at Galatians 5 and verse 7. I'll read it for you. You did run well, Paul says to the Galatians. Who did hinder you that you should not obey the truth? See, no matter what comes against you, what hinders you, you should and must obey the truth.
Amen.
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 Remember, you are in the presence of God. Jesus is your cloud by day and your fire by night. Amen. Somebody read for us Proverbs chapter 4, verses 10 to 12.
Hear, O my son, and receive my sayings, and the years of thy life shall be many. I have taught thee in the way of wisdom. I have led thee in the right paths. When thou goest, thy steps shall not be straitened. And when thou runnest, thou shalt not stumble.
Amen. Amen. Thy steps shall not be straitened or narrowed or constricted. And when you run, you will not stumble. Amen. And then, of course, last but certainly not least, Isaiah chapter 40 and verse 31. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint.
Amen.
Now, today, if you are struggling, maybe you're weary, maybe you're stagnating, you know the condition of your own spiritual being. Maybe it's not as it once was. Get your eyes back on the prize. Amen? See, some may need to go back and find where you left your first love. Amen. Left your first love. Amen. You chose to be born again. At that time, you chose to be heaven bound. True? If you go back to that day, you chose to be born again. Nobody forced you. It was an invitation. You chose to accept the invitation. You chose to be heaven bound. Now, all that you and I must do is complete the journey. Amen. And of course, there will be twists, there'll be turns, there'll be obstacles, there'll be sacrifices, there'll be disciplines that we must follow. There'll be hindrances and disappointments and rejections. You can be assured of that. Write it down. There'll be trials and tribulations. Write it down. It's assured.
Amen.
But what should we do? What must we do? Our eye must be on our heart's longing. The prize. Amen. Amen. I'm going to stop there and let you mull that over and think about it. Amen. But God has many plans and many purposes. But he wants you and I to concentrate on the one plan, one purpose now, moment by moment. Amen. Not be idle, but run. We're going to, you can't walk into heaven. You've got to run into heaven. Isn't that right? That's what Paul said. He ran. Got to run. You got to run for heaven. I don't know. Have any of you ever tried running?
No.
We've all tried walking.
Hard.
You find, hey, when you're walking, your mind can wander all over the place, can't it? I'll tell you what, when you're running, your mind seems to become very constricted. Amen. Between getting to the end of where you're running to, hopefully with your lungs and heart still in your body.
Okay.
Isn't that right?
And watching where you're going to make sure you don't step into a hole.
You don't have to worry about the holes. God will get you over the holes.
Okay.
He'll keep your heart and lungs inside your body. But he says, run. Give no thought about it. Yeah, because I said, when you're walking, your thoughts can be all over the place. But he says, give it your all. Amen. Let 2023 be give it your all. Hey, if it's not serving God, give it your all to that which you long for. If it is serving God, give your all to that. Amen. We don't have to be like the Church of the Laodiceans. We don't have to be lukewarm. Amen. Give yourself to the one or the other. Don't sit in the middle. That's painful. Amen. Let me stop there. I'm going to play that song again for you. All right? Is that okay?
Yeah.